Hello guys, welcome to Bhavna's Online Academy. So this video is the part 2 of the chapter 3 of EIS. So if you still haven't watched the part 1, I'll link it that in the I button here. You can click on that and go watch part 1 first so that you're able to understand this better. So let's get into the video.
Yes. So I was talking about database. So there is a hierarchy in database. Okay, so what is this hierarchy? We'll understand and then we'll go on to understand what are the different models. Now first let's understand what is database. Okay, so what happens is, this is the hierarchy how your database is usually stored. Okay, so what happens is, now here we have taken a example. Okay, so here this example you can take. Here you have something known as account code, account head and group head. Okay, so this whatever columns are there, these columns will be known as fields. These columns are known as fields. Whatever your rows are there, that will be known as your record. This fields and record together, whatever your columns are, it will be known as fields, and whatever your rows are, it will be known as record. This record and field will together make a file. This record and together, this as a whole will make a file. This file is also known as table or entity, and this collection of files can be known as a database. Did you guys understand? I think I should go to the ICAI book for this. Give me a minute. I'll just study from the ICAI book so you're able to understand better. Software, data, database management system. Yes. See here, see, we have the hierarchy of database. So what is a database? So database is nothing but a collection of files or tables. What is this file or table? The file or table is nothing but a collection of records. Now they told database is a collection of file or table. Now what is a file or table? It is a collection of records. This is nothing like how what you say is, who is the mother of this child? The mother of this child is the suppose if somebody asks who are you, you can directly either say your name, or you can say that I am my grandfather's or my grandmother's grandson or grandchild. Who is your grandfather or grandmother? They are my my mom and dad's mother and father. So like this, they are just going on the loop round and round. Okay, so database is nothing but your files or tables. What is file or table? It is nothing but your record. What is your record? A record is a collection of field. What is a field? It is a collection of characters. What is characters? Characters are a collection of bits. So what happens is, this is actually a file. Okay, collection of these, if you have 2 to 3 more files like this, that will be known as a database. File and database is clear. What is in a file? What is inside a file? Inside a file, it is a collection of records. So records is nothing but this, each one is a record. This is a record, this is a record, this is a record. So that is a record. What is a record? In each record, you have a file. This is a file. Sorry, field. This is a field. This is a field. This is a field. In each field, you have a few characters. Suppose your field is account head. In account head, you will have traveling, you have printing, you have repair. These are nothing but your characters. So I hope this is clear. Do you have any doubt in this? What is a database, file, record, field, and character? It's not like okayish topic. Do you have any doubt in this? Yes or no? No, right? Okay. Because I just don't have interest to explain it. That's why I'm just glancing it over. I want to explain. What happened? Just a second. Okay. Yes. So I want to explain the database management models. Okay. So totally you have 4 database management models, as you can see on your screen. What happened? My laptop touch is not working. Okay. Yes, it is. Okay. So you have 4 database models. One is hierarchical database model. Next is network database models. Then you have relational database model. And then you have object-oriented database model. So you totally have 4 database model: hierarchical database model, network database model, relational database model, and object-oriented database model. How are these 4 classified? Is that it stores data in different formats, like in different models. Hierarchical stores in one way, network stores shows in another way. The same data, you can say, it can store in different methods or different models, that these are the four models. And now these four models, we are going to understand in details. Now just repeat after me, what are the four models? Hierarchical database model, network database model, relational database model, object-oriented database model. Okay. So now we'll go on to the text. Okay. Once again, guys, it's just getting loaded. Did it load? Okay, it has. Okay. Now, first we'll start with a hierarchical database model. Okay, we'll not read through the text anything. First, I'll explain you what it is. Then we'll read through the text. Okay, what is this thing, guys? What is this? What is this? What is the image here? What is the image that is there? Can you please tell me what is the image that is shown? That is a... You guys are not able to see or what? What is this? Root? No. This is a reverse tree. Very good, Bhavesh. This is a reverse tree. This is nothing but a inverted tree. This is nothing but your inverted tree. So what happens usually when your tree is there? Usually what happens? Your tree has branches like this. Okay, your tree has branches like this. But what happens in this tree? You have a tree like this and you have your branches like this, correct? So this is nothing but, this is what is your hierarchical database. Sorry. This is... Okay. This is nothing but your hierarchical database model. So in this, the data is stored like this only, in the form of a inverse tree. Like, see, you will have one thing here, then it will go like this, then it will go like this, like this, like this, it can go like this, like this, like this. So this is just like your inverted tree, right? This database model, your data is stored in this form only. This is just like your inverted tree. That is your hierarchical database model. This is how your hierarchical database model will look. This is how your data is stored in a hierarchical database model. Now I'll show you an example for that. He's just taking a lot of time to load. I don't know why. Okay. So see, this looks like your reverse tree, right? So what happens if you suppose have information about your college, you want to give information about your college. So what happens is in college, you have departments, and regarding its infrastructure, you want to give details. So under college only they both come. Whereas in departments, you want to, under department, you want to give information about what courses are given in each department. What are the teachers in every department? What are the types of students or the student name in each department? In course, what kind of courses you have? You have theory courses also, you have practical courses also. So like that, this is how your data is stored in a hierarchical database model. It is stored like a inverted tree pattern. Okay, so I hope that is clear to you. Okay, is there something that you want to explain? Okay, there is this illustration I thought I'll explain, but I don't think that there is a need. I think you guys have already understood what this is. Okay, so I'm not explaining you the illustration now. Okay, so hierarchical database model. So hierarchical database model, what they tell you is whatever the records or nodes are, like, okay, so whatever the records or nodes are, they are logically organized. I already told you, whenever it is inside a database, it will be logically organized only. Okay, how is it logically organized? It is logically organized into an inverted tree pattern, just like how I showed you up. Okay, so data is stored like an inverted tree pattern. Okay, it follows a parent and child relationship. It follows a parent and child relationship. Here, I'll give you an example. Suppose I have the data of my family. Suppose if I have the data of my family, okay, what happens is that I have my grandfather or grandmother. Okay, I have my voice breaking again. Is the voice breaking, guys? No? Okay. Others, can you please say? No. Okay, I think there's some network issue with your internet. You can just check that. Suppose I have my grandfather or grandmother. Okay, my grandfather and grandmother have 6 children. One of which is my dad, suppose. Okay, so my dad has one child. That is me. Okay, that is me. Okay, my dad's sister. That is my, my dad's sister. Okay, that is one of the child of my grandfather or grandmother. They have three children, suppose. So this is nothing but an inverted tree pattern only. So you have one parent here, and under each parent you have a child, and under each parent you have a child. This is what is known as inverted tree pattern or hierarchical database model. Okay, so so see, grandfather or grandmother will be your parent, they all will be your child, and in when it comes to me, they will be my parent and I will be their child. Okay, so this is a model that a hierarchical database also follows. So it follows a parent-child relationship. Okay, so the top record in the hierarchy that all other records, that means the top record in the hierarchy, that is this record in the hierarchy, my grandfather or grandmother record, is the record which owns everybody else, right? They are the people who own everybody else. So they are the they will be known as the parent or root record. They will be known as a, because of them only our family has actually grown, right? So they will be either known as the parent record or the root record. So they will be known as my parent record or root record. Okay, next, which may have one or more child. They have, may have either one child also, they may have more children also. Okay, so hierarchical database model, what it we read, that it is in the form of an inverted tree pattern. It follows a parent-child relationship. The topmost record, that is the grandfather or grandmother record, will be the record which, it is the record which owns all other records. So it will be known as a parent record or root record, and under that record, they may have one or more child records. So in a hierarchical database model, you can only have see, no child can record may have more than one parent record. That means if I am the child, I should not have more than one parent record. In my parent, both mother and father is combined. Okay, here always remember, in the example of my family example, here parent refers to both dad and mom. Both dad and mom. So here what it tells you is that no child, that means me, I should not have more than one parent record. That means I must not have more than one dad or mom. That is what it is trying to tell you. That means if I have one child, if there is one child, I should only have one parent. Or even if the parent has 3 to 4 child, all those 3 to 4 childs must only have one parent. Do you guys understand what I'm trying to tell you? If there is one child to a mother or a father, that one child must only have one mother or father. If the mother or father has 3 to 4 children, all those 3 to 4 children must have the same or one mother or father only. So this is what I've shown you through images here. Okay. Hierarchical database structure implements 1-to-1. That means one parent, one child, or 1-to-many. That means one parent, many childs. Okay, only you can have only two types of relationship here, 1-to-1 or 1-to-many. Here you cannot have many to one or many to many relationships. You can only have 1-to-1. You can only have 1-to-1 or 1-to-many relationships. You cannot have many to one or many to many relationships. I hope this is clear to you guys. Is hierarchical database model clear to you guys? If it is clear, please answer. Try to answer this question. IBM Information Management System, which used a hierarchical database model, was previously used by Finisys system. Okay, what type of relationship is not supported by this database model? There are 4 relationships given below. Which relationship is not supported by hierarchical database model? 1-to-1 or many to one or 1-to-many? B, many to one. Very good, guys. Very nice. Very good. Many to one. Awesome, guys. You're doing a great job for the first reading. Okay. So we have now understood what is hierarchical database model. So this is one type how you can store a data. Next, we are going to study something known as a network database model. Next, we are going to study something known as a network database model. Okay. Oh, just a second, guys. Once again. I just get my charger for my laptop once again. Thank you. Okay, yes. Why is it not charging? Yes, it's okay. Okay, sorry for the disturbance. Yes, what was he saying? I was talking about network database model. Okay. So network database model. So network database model, I'll give you an example here. Here you can see. So whenever you go to a vegetable shop, all of us here might have gone to the vegetable shop, okay? So whenever you go to a vegetable shop, there are a few vegetable shops which give you two kinds of produce. It will give you also organic produce and it will give you non-organic produce. You might have gone to a few stores where they only sell organic vegetables and fruits, and you also might have seen non-organic vegetables and fruits. Suppose there is one such store, and this store gives both organic also, non-organic also. Then in such a shop, what might happen is, if suppose there are lemon, if there are limes, if there are grapes, bananas, onions, broccoli, then what will happen is all these things will be available in the organic format alone, organic format also. It will also be available in the non-organic format, correct? All these vegetables and fruits will be available in organic format alone also, and non-organic format also. So in such case, whenever you are preparing a database, what you can do is you can write here produce, and you can write organic, non-organic, and you can connect organic lemon here and non-organic lemon here, like that. Crisscross, it can go. Okay, crisscross here it can go. That means one child can have more than one parent. That means, I'll show you once again, I'll just erase this. Okay, so here what happens is that here you can see that broccoli, suppose it is one child, then in such case this one child can have more than one parent. It can also have a non-organic parent and it can also have an organic parent. Do you agree with me or not? Can broccoli as a child have organic and non-organic parent both? So what happens is, such kind of a data which can have more than one parent is stored in something, is stored in a form known as network database model. Which only has one parent, it will be stored in a hierarchical database. Which has more than one parent, it will be stored in a network database model. I hope you would have seen this family. Okay, this family, I don't know if you have seen or not. This is the world's largest family. Okay, this is the world's largest family. The man standing here, okay, this is the only father. He is the only father, and all these who are standing here, they are all his wives and all their children. I think he has around some 50 to 100 wives and more than like 200 children. Okay, he has a whole colony or a whole apartment with him. Okay. So this kind of a family can come can be told as many to one or many to many. That means one child might have two different parents. Many to many means crisscross, anything can happen. I hope you guys understand this better. Okay, so many to one, many to many. Okay, so this is an example of network database model. Okay, so now we'll try to understand. Okay, I hope the concept of network database model is clear to you guys. Network database is a variation of hierarchy model. It is like hierarchical only, but there is some slight variation. Okay, here the branches can be connected to multiple nodes. Here these branches, whichever these branches are, it can be connected to multiple nodes. Okay, a network database structure views all records in sets. So here all these records, this record, this record, this records, all these records are viewed in form of sets, and each set is composed of an owner record and one or more member records. So here what they tell you is that once again, guys, I just made a mistake while explaining it to you here. So in last thing we studied as a parent-child relationship, right? Here they don't have a parent-child relationship. Rather, these all will be known as a owner and member record here. In hierarchical database model, it was known as parent-child relationship. In this network database model, it will be known as a owner-member record. Okay, so each record is known as, here it was known as a parent record. Here it will be known as a owner record or a owner set, you can say. Okay, so owner record. So each set is composed of an owner record. owner record and one or more member records allows the network to model to implement many to one and many to many relationship types. So this is all about network database models. There you have parent and child, here you have owner and member. It is a slight variation of hierarchical model, and also here you have many to one and many to many relationships. So I hope this network database model is also clear to you guys. So that is one form of storing your data. Next, we are going to study about relational database model. So in relational database model, how do you store data? Once again. Switch off. Okay. Next, you have relational database model. So in this model, how do you store data? In the first model, you stored it in the form of inverted tree. Here in second network also, it was inverted tree, but the relationships were different. Next is relational database model. In this, you store your data in the form of tables. You store the data in the form of tables. See, like this, in the form of tables, you store this data. Okay? Yes. So now what they tell you is, when you store a database in the form of table, first let's see an example. I think that will be better. Okay. So now see, this is how I have stored my data here. So first what I have is, I have a table one. There are two sets of data that I have stored here. First set of data is in data table one. Second set of data is in my table two. Once again, guys. Akka. கதவு மட்டும் மூடிடுங்க. ஃபேன் ஆன் பண்ணிக்கிறேன், நோ ப்ராப்ளம். தேங்க்ஸ்க்கா. ஓகே ஓகே, வாட் வாஸ் யூ சேயிங்? ஐ வாஸ் டாக்கிங் அபவுட் டேபிள் ஒன் அண்ட் டேபிள் டூ. ஸோ இன் டேபிள் ஒன், ஓகே, ஸோ டேபிள் ஒன், தேர் ஆர் டூ கைண்ட்ஸ் ஆஃப் டேபிள்ஸ். எஸ், ஸோ இன் திஸ் டேபிள் ஒன் யூ ஹாவ் சம் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் இன்ஃபர்மேஷன், அண்ட் இன் திஸ் டேபிள் டூ யூ ஹாவ் சம் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் அனதர் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் இன்ஃபர்மேஷன். ஸோ இன் டேபிள் ஒன் யூ ஹாவ் இன்ஃபர்மேஷன்ஸ் ரிலேட்டிங் டு ஏஜென்ட்ஸ், whereas in table 2 you have information relating to entertainers. So agent, so you have your agent ID here, agent first name here, agent last name here, date of hire, when did you put them on appointment, what is the agent's home, that is phone number, all these data you have in the table form here. So this is how you store data in the form of data under relational database model. Okay. In table 2, you have entertainer ID. You also have agent ID. You have entertainer name and entertainer phone and other fields. Okay. So before I get into the details of relational database model, there are a few things that I would like to tell you. The table is a collection of records and fields. I already told you what is records and what is fields, so I don't want to explain it again. So in a relational database model, it is shown in the form of tables, and these tables are a collection of records and fields. Okay. So how are these? Here it was connected using branches, right? In the other in other database models. So here in this relational database models, how are two database connected? How are two different types of databases connected? The answer here is that a unique key identifies each row. A unique key identifies each row called a primary memory. And the keys are commonly used to join or combine data from two or more tables. Now we'll understand this in detail. So what happens is that, here you have tables. Here you have tables, but these tables are not connected to one another. Here, just like you saw, here these tables are not connected to one another in the form of parent or child relationships. So you don't actually have a connection between the both in the form of parent or child or what was another one? Owner and member. So you don't have connection. So how will you form these connections here? So what happens is, you can access data from any table, but how will you access this? How will you form a connection? So all these tables will be connected by unique key identifiers called primary key. So something known as the primary key will connect these two tables. Now see, so in table one, you have, in table one, what will happen is you will have, so in table one, you will have a lot of fields. Okay. You will have a lot of fields. So now suppose I can pick one of the fields as my primary key. Suppose I pick my agent ID as a primary field. In such case, what happens is that if the same primary key or the agent ID, that field is used in some other table, then these both tables can be connected. See, here I have again put up a agent ID. So by using this, you can connect two or more tables. If the primary key of one table is connected to another table, then that field is connected to another table, then in such case, these both will get connected using a primary key. So it is not important that in table two also, this agent ID must be a primary key. Their primary key might be a entertainer ID also. But what happens is primary key of table one will become a foreign key of table two. So how are two tables connected? Using primary key, that is a field of table one will be appearing in a table two also. So a primary key of table one can be appearing in the table two as a foreign key. So this foreign key is how you connect two tables. So foreign key to this table, maybe primary key to some other table. I hope you understand. So to connect two different tables, you must use primary key in another table. The primary key of one table, if you use it in another table, then the two tables can get connected. I hope the concept of primary key is clear to you now. So that is what is written here. So a unique key that is known as the primary key identifies each row called as primary key. Commonly, these keys are commonly used to join or combine data from two or more tables. Okay, so this is how a relational database model works. So here in relational database models, what is the relations that you have? You have a relationship that is in the form of a table using columns and rows. So what are attributes? The columns which is there here, no? This columns is named. Okay, the named columns of the relations are known as attributes. That means, see, if you see this table, you know, I'll just remove it. Okay, so this is a column. Okay, and this thing is a row. This is a row, this is a column. So what happens is that this column is there, you know. So both these rows and columns, when they get together, and they form a table. Okay, that you understood. So what is attributes? That means in column, the named columns of the relations are called as attributes. That means this. The agent first name is an attribute. Agent last name is an attribute. So in the column, which is a named column, you know, the name of the column will be known as the attribute. That is the agent's first name or agent ID or agent last name or things like that. Next, you have domains. Domains means a set of values the attributes can take. That means in this attributes, under agent first name, you have Stella, Steve, Randy. Okay, so all these things are nothing but your, names are nothing but your domains. Okay, the set of values or the set of names that your attributes can take is known as the domain. So suppose what will happen is that if suppose I have something known as a agent ID, suppose I have an attribute. Okay, I told you already that agent ID, agent first name. Now we'll take these both. So this is one attribute and this is another attribute. This attribute of mine can only take numbers. So this numbers or the sets of or the set of values which the attribute can take will be known as domain. So here my domain is numbers, whereas here I cannot write numbers. Here I can only give alphabets. So here my domain is alphabet. So whatever the value or the set of value which each domain, which each attribute can take will be known as a domain. The domain is nothing but, if for a agent ID attribute, if your domain is numbers, then you can only give numbers there. If your agent first name attribute, your set of values is alphabets, then only alphabets will be your domain. Okay, I hope you understood what is relations, attributes, and domains. You have any doubt in that case? You have any doubts in attributes, domains, and relationships? I mean relations, sorry. Is it clear? Can I get a thumbs up from you? So we studied about three models: hierarchical model, network model, and relational database model. Now we are going to start with object-oriented database model. My stylus is not working. Just a second, guys. Yes, it is. Okay. Object-oriented. Okay, object-oriented database model. Okay, so now you're going to study about object-oriented database model. Okay, so before we dive into the text, we'll just have a glance on this. So see, data can be divided into two forms. One is structured data, another one is unstructured data. So data can be of two types. One is structured data, and another one is unstructured data. Structured data means a data which can be structured data means a data which can be easily and nicely fit into fields. That means if you type in some kind of alphabets, you can easily put it in the table, or if you try to type any number, that you can easily put it into a table, like how you saw a relational data in this table. You know, easily you can put a text into this table, easily you can put a number into this table. That is a structured data. But what happens when you try to put in unstructured data? What is unstructured data? Maybe a video, maybe an audio file, or maybe an image. So all these things are unstructured data. Structured data are the things which gets fit easily into these kinds of databases, like how you see the tables here, no? In those databases. But unstructured database, unstructured data is a form of data where, you know, whatever data you're trying to put inside will not fit nicely into the field. Suppose if you're trying to type a name called as Bunty, that you can easily type into that table. But if you're trying to paste the picture of Bunty, that is the image of Bunty, that will be quite difficult for you to put into it. Okay, it will not nicely fit into it. Suppose, see, this is suppose that your table, this are your columns, this are your rows. See, how will it fit properly? It will not fit properly. Like, whereas if you are trying to write a name, you can zoom in and you can write here Bunty like this. Okay, so this problem may happen. So in such case, what will happen is, in such case only a concept known as object-oriented database model came into picture. So what happens is that this unstructured data, what it does is that it uses BLOB language. There is a language or a program, you can say, known as the BLOB language, that is binary large object block, binary large object block. So unstructured data uses BLOB language and it tries to help the image fit into the field. So using this language, the unstructured data helps the image to fit into the field. So in this object-oriented database model, as the name suggests, we are going to see how to fit in, how does the database tries to fit in the videos, images, and also other forms of unstructured data to get into it. Okay, so here, as you can see, so here you can see this picture. It is about your audio, it is about your video, it is about your pictures, okay. So how is this object-oriented database model? In a few, we saw that there was a rows and columns. That means there were fields and records. And then we saw there was parent child. There was a member and owner type. Here, what they have is, here they have it in the name of objects. So each database is a set of objects. So many objects will be there inside it. So see, let's give it a read so you understand better. So modeled in terms of objects and their interactions. So how these objects work together or interact together, in that way, related to that objects, you build a database. Okay. So an object-oriented database provides a mechanism to store complex data. What are the complex data which can't be stored in other database models? That is your pictures, images, audios, and videos. So that things it will help you. This object-oriented database model will help you to store. An object-oriented database model, also known as object-oriented database management system or OODBMS, these are the other names for it, is a set of objects. Objects means nothing but your images, audio, and video. Data stored in the form. So here what happens is the data which is stored in this database is stored in the form of objects. That is audio, video, or image and things like that. Okay. In this database, the data is modeled and created as objects. Okay. That means audio will be taken and will be created as an object. I'll show you image so you're able to understand better in a while. OODBMS helps the programmers make objects which are independently functioning application or program. That means one image need not be related to another image. It can be independent objects in itself. Okay. Next, it is assigned with a specific task or role to perform. It has a specific task or role to perform. See, one of the most technical topics in the four database models is object-oriented database model. Even if you didn't understand it as much as you understood the other three, it's completely okay. Because in our books, the information that is required for you to understand it is not actually given. Directly, they have given you the complex things. So just understand that it is a mechanism which stores complex data. Okay. And it is stored in the form of objects. And these objects are independently functioning application or program. They are not dependent on each other. These three points you can remember and write it in your exam and come. Okay. So here, once again, guys. So here, So here you have a MCQ once again. So here you have an MCQ which you can try to answer. Which among the following database models makes use of independently functioning application or program to perform specific task? Independently performing. D, object database model. Very good. Others? D, once again. Yes, okay. Object database. Very good, guys. Very good. Nice. So like this only in the exam, they will ask you questions from one of the most, you know, the points that these points you might miss, but this is very important. Okay, the answer is D. Very good. D. Okay. Okay, so that was all about our database model. So like this in the form of objects, you don't need to see this picture, guys. We'll just delete it from here. Okay, one second. Ma, door close karona. Door close karona. Oreo. Kun movie dekh rahe hai? Okay guys, so yes, so what was I saying? We completed with the four topics of database. Once again, it is just, I don't know why it's taking us so much time to load. Okay, yes, so in data resources we were studying about the components of information system. We completed hardware, software, people. We had network and data left, and one part of data we have completed: data, database, database management system, database models. All these four things we have completed. Next, there are a few terms which are related to database. There are three terms related to database: big data, data warehouse, and data mining. These three things we will understand, and finally we have network. And if you understand these, then that's it. The chapter, I mean not the chapter, but today's portion is complete. Okay. So big data. So we'll start with we'll start with data warehouse. Actually, we'll not go in the order. We'll start with data warehouse. Okay. So this is the image of a data warehouse, guys. Okay, this is the image of a data. This is the data warehouse. Okay. So what happens in a data warehouse is that you get a data from a lot of different sources. You can get it from operational system, or you can get it from different kinds of sources. You will get a data. All these data, what will happen is you will come and you will load into a staging area. You will come and load into a staging area. Okay, listen, database and data warehouse are completely different concepts. So database and data warehouse, don't confuse yourself. In the end, I'll tell you what is the difference between database and data warehouse. For now, clear your mind and just concentrate on data warehouse. Don't get confused. Okay. So data warehouse. So what happens in a data warehouse is that a lot of data comes to you. Okay. And what you do is all these data which comes to you, you put it into one tub, into red color. You can see this red color tub here. You will put into this red color tub. So all the data which you have accumulated, it will be put into this red color tub. And this red color tub is known as the staging area. This is known as staging area. So what happens in this staging area is, I'll just tell you in a moment. Okay. So what happens is, once this is all collected in a tub, here some kind of a process will happen in the staging area. And then the data, the information will be sent to your warehouse. This is your warehouse. Okay. And then once it has been gone to the warehouse, it will send the data to different departments. It can send to purchasing department, sales departments, inventory department, relating to whoever the data is needed. It will send those data to them. Okay. These data which are sent to specific departments like purchase, sales or inventory will be known as data marts. Okay. Then these data marts can be used by the users. Whoever wants to use this for analysis or reporting or mining, they can use it. Okay, now I'll explain it to you in detail. So what happens is that, once again, I just erase my text also once again, guys. Okay, so what happens is that once you collect your data sources into this red color tub, that is your staging area, what happens is that, so whenever data is collected, it will be collected into different kind of formats. Okay, here they have given you here I have given you example of DDMMYY. So what might happen is that there might be, suppose, two departments. There will be sales departments And there will be production departments. So production department stores their data in the form of DD, MM, YY, date, month and year. Whereas sales department stores in the form of MM, DD, YY, that is month, date and year. So when these two information goes into a data warehouse only accepts information which is standardized. Data warehouse only accepts information which is standardized. That means everything or whatever the if suppose there is some information about date, it must be standardized. That means it must either follow DD MM YY or it must follow MM DD YY. Two kinds of data and all it won't accept. So it needs to be standardized. Whatever data is being sent to the data warehouse, it must be standardized. So in such case, what happens is all the data which has come goes into this red color tub, as I told you. In this red color tub, a process is done to make the data in a standardized form. A process is done to make the data into a standardized form before sending it to the data warehouse. That process is known as an ETL process. ETL is nothing but extraction, transformation and load. Extraction, transformation and load. So whatever data is has come, first the data will be extracted. Then if suppose there are two kinds of data which has come, MMDDYY and DDMMYY, these both data will be extracted. Then it will be transformed. So production data, first it will check, is it in the form of DDMMYY? Yes, so it will not do anything. Sales data, it will check, it is in the form of MMDDYY. So then it will transform the MMDDYY into DDMMYY. So once it has been transformed, then it will load it into the warehouse. Then it will load it into the warehouse. So what this red tub or the staging area does is it extracts the information, it transforms into a standardized form, and it then loads into the data warehouse. Now from the data warehouse, whatever department's information is there, it has been sent to that department, and department-wise information or department-wise data storage can be known as data marts, and that can be used by the users. Okay, here there is a text that I've picked up from the ICI book. We'll just read through it. So data warehouse to match up date standard format would have to be agreed upon. That means whatever date, in what standard format date you want your data to be, first itself you have to agree and keep. And all data loaded into the data warehouse would have to be converted to this standard format. Okay, so standard format only you can convert and send. This process of converting into standard format is known as extraction, transformation and load. I hope the concept of extraction, transformation and load is clear to you all, and what is the process of warehouse is also clear to you. Now we are going to start seeing about it in detail. Okay. Okay. So what happens is that so there are two primary school of thoughts. That means first we'll read about what is a data warehouse and then I'll tell you about it. Okay. Data warehouse. What is a data warehouse? Data warehouse is nothing but a storage place. It is a huge repository of data. Repository means storage place. What is a data warehouse? Data warehouse is a huge repository of data. Now you may think, what is the difference between data and database and data warehouse? Then both are storing things only. Database is also storing your data only. Data warehouse is also storing your data only. Okay. Now I will tell you the difference first. Then we'll move on. Okay, so what happens, what is the difference between data and data warehouse is that see here you can see, now we are going to take the example of Flipkart. So I hope all of you must have already used Flipkart sometime in your life. Okay, so what happens is in Flipkart day-to-day transactions will happen. The details or the data regarding this day-to-day transactions will be stored in a database. Whatever is operational, that means day-to-day whatever is happening, it will be stored in a database. Whereas if you take Flipkart, you have a big billion days that will come. You know that big billion days come, right? Like how for Amazon, it is the Great Indian... what was that? I just forgot the name, I'm sorry. The Great Indian Sale, I guess. For Flipkart, it is the big billion days sale. So like that, a sale might come for a Flipkart. So on such... So this is a non-operational. This does not happen day to day, right? This does not happen day to day. This is kind of a non-operational. So whatever data is formed during this big billion days is collected, and this data is stored into a data warehouse. I hope you are clear. So again, I will tell you. So in Flipkart, whatever date today transaction happens, that is stored in a database. Whereas like this, if non-operational data is there, doesn't occur daily and daily, those data are stored in data warehouse. Okay, see, here you can see the difference. So it stores current real-time information. That means day-to-day, whatever is happening, that will be stored in a database. Whereas in a data warehouse, non-operational data will be stored, like your data of Big Billion Days. In Big Billion Days, there will be lots and lots of data which you will get, because that is the time of the year when the Flipkart is the most active, because it will have a great deals running on the platform. So this, on this day, you will get a large amount of data, right? That will be stored in the data warehouse. Okay. So why is it differently stored in database, and why is this data stored in data warehouse? Now we will understand. Okay. So in database, why you store it I'll just tell you the third point, then I'll come to the second point. So in database, the function is to record. Whatever happens day to day, you just record. You don't do anything. You just record whatever happens daily, okay? Just to maintain a record, store it in the database. Whereas in the data warehouse, the function is to report and analyze. That means what it will do is whatever happens in the Big Billion Days sale, all the data it will take and store it into the data warehouse. This data will be used. It will be analyzed. That what is the product which is most purchased by the customer during this Big Billion Days? What kind of customers are purchasing? Are the customers purchasing from credit cards or debit cards? Are they purchasing using cash on delivery? Or what else? On how much percentage if we deals we give, they are purchasing more, like that. So what they will analyze this data. So what happens is, suppose in this year what happened was they analyzed the data and they found out that people were purchasing more using suppose HDFC credit card or debit card. Credit card or debit card, they were using more to purchase this time. Okay. What will they do is, next time whenever they bring an offer, in the payment also they might have a few offers running, right? In the payment area also they might have an offers running. In such case, in HDFC credit or debit card, they'll not give offer at all, because then that will be a loss to them, right? In other payment options, they will give you an offer. Okay, so like this, they will analyze whatever data has happened during the Big Billion Day sale and on what product are people purchasing more. So anyway, people are purchasing more means they are giving less discounts on it. Or products they don't purchase more, they give heavy discount. Like that they will do. Okay, so like that they will analyze the data, okay, and help you to report and analyze. So this is the difference between database and data warehouse. Database, you use OLTP, that is online transaction processing, that is transactions you process. Here you do analytical processes. It is OLAP, OLAP, online analytical processing. Okay, so that is the difference between database and data warehouse. I hope the difference is clear to you guys. Do you have any doubts in the difference, guys? You have any doubts? No? I hope it's no. Okay. So next. Okay. So what were we reading? We were studying about data warehouse. So here we read that it is a huge repository of data. Okay. Information system used for storing historical data. Historical data we just saw, like past year data and all, is also stored so that you are able to analyze and get information out of it. Next. Pulls data from different sources within an organization. It is not only important that it gets from one source. It can get its data from customers. It can get its data from suppliers. It can get data from the payment vendors. It can get data from, different kinds of people who were managing the Big Billion Days sale. From different kinds of sources, they can get data and put it into a data warehouse. Mainly, this is used for analysis and reporting purpose only, guys. Okay, and it assists in business decision making. That means next time when you have a Big Billion Day sale, you may take a good, better decision to increase the profit of Flipkart. I hope that is clear. Also, we read this also. What is the process involved in the concept of database? You extract information, you transform into a standardized format, and then you load it into the data warehouse. Okay, data. If I just said database, I'm sorry, it was data warehouse. Okay, we'll just read it in detail. Extract, transform, and load. Extract means extracting data from one or more active databases from the organization. So a data warehouse, this data warehouse can also take information from the database. If suppose it needs any information from database also, it can need, okay, it can take. And loading the extracted data to a temporary area called a staging area. So in that red tab, they will load all the data which is extracted, transform. So it will perform necessary operation, data edit to make the extracted data standardized. I already told you. This load the data after necessary transformation into data warehouse for storage and analysis. So whatever data is necessary, after transformation, it will load it into the data warehouse. This is extract, transform and load. Here they have given you characteristics of a data warehouse. So it is the first non-operational data that I already told you. It is standardized, that also I told you. Here they have given you a time variant. Time variant means what? Means data which is loaded into the data warehouse. You know, it is always loaded with a time stamp. That means at this minute, this second, this date, this day, this data was loaded into the data warehouse. Like that, time stamps will also be there. So there are three characteristics of data warehouse. It is a time variant. That means time stamp. The data is loaded with time stamp into the data warehouse. It is a non-operational data and also it is a standardized data. Okay. Now we will give me a minute, guys. Okay. Okay. Can you just answer this question? During the discussion relating to the implementation of data warehouse, Finch system is quite apprehensive of whether comparisons could be made between different time period of information. Which feature of data warehouse makes this possible? They are thinking whether they'll be able to make time period information of a time period. I mean, comparisons between different information of different time period. See, time variant. Very good. So time variant is one thing which will help you in determining the time factor. Okay. Yes. Very good, guys. Very nice. Applause. Okay. So what was he saying? So yeah, we just studied about what is data warehouse. So I told you what are the three criteria. Three criteria were nothing but the three characteristics of data warehouse. Okay. Next, you have two primary school of thoughts. That means they tell you that in data warehouse, here I would have written, how you can design your data warehouse in two ways. One is top-down approach. Once again. Okay. One is top-down approach, another one is bottom-up approach. So what might happen is top-down approach means you have all the information in the data warehouse, and from there all the informations are sent to data marts. That means are collected into data marts. Data marts means nothing but related to a specific function. That means related to sales or related to purchase or related to production, procurement, like that, different specific functions related data will be there in a data mart. Whereas in a data warehouse, all the information will be there. That is the difference between data warehouse and data mart. So from data warehouse, you can send all the information to data mart. Or from all these tiny data mart, you can send the information to data warehouse. If from data warehouse, the information is sent to data mart, that will be top-down approach. If from data mart, it is sent to data warehouse, the information will be known as bottom-up approach. So these are the two types of approaches. Just have a read here. See, what happens is that there are different approaches of designing a data warehouse. You can design data warehouse in two formats. One is top-down approach, one is bottom-up approach. If we saw that after staging area, it directly came to data warehouse. It may also happen so that it may go to data mart and then go to data warehouse. So it may be anyway. So creating an enterprise-wide data warehouse and then creating as per need. That means first you create a enterprise-wide data warehouse. That means all the information you dump into one data warehouse, and then according to your need, sales, purchase, finance, accounting, like that, you create data marts, like you create as per your needs. Bottom-up approach means already, already what has happened is that already you have created small data marts according to your specific user needs. You have already created data marts and then you combine them all to form a data warehouse. Okay. I hope this is also clear to you all. Okay. Next, benefits I'm not going to study. You can study by your own and understand. We have 10 minutes left. So, okay, we'll cover the big data. Big data. What is big data? As the name suggests, big data. Big data means big data. Okay, that is what is big data. Now, if you study, you'll understand. Okay, which just go where the information is given. Yes. So what is big data? So now we have covered the concept of data warehouse. Now we are going to study what is big data. So the term refers to massively large sets that conventional database tools do not have the storage and processing power to analyze them. Okay. So what it tries to tell you is that, see, our databases which were there, you know, are conventional. That means a traditional database which we just read and have come down. These databases, you know, what happens is if there is very big data, it will not be able to store, process, or analyze them. A lot of data or big data, this traditional database do not have the tools. It does not have the tools, or it is not built in such a way that it can store, process or analyze large amount of data or massively large data sets. Okay. So what happens is, to solve this problem of database only, a technology known as the big data technology came into picture. What this big data technology helps you do is that it helps you to store, process and analyze the big data. So listen to me once again. So your traditional database are not built in such a way, or they do not have the tools to store, process and analyze very big data. So in such case, what happens is a big data technology was built, which was used for handling the big data, to store them, to process them and to analyze them. So this is nothing but your big data technology. So some examples of industries that are using big data analytics, including hospitality industry, healthcare companies, public service agencies and retail businesses. So in these examples, you will have to remember, guys, which kinds of industries use big data. Okay. If you want to know more about big data, you can go on YouTube and search about it. In our book, this much is only given. This much only we will study. Okay. Okay. Answer this question, guys. As a business of Finisys system have grown tremendously, it has grown tremendously over the past few years, and found that SQL Server DBMS, that is, it is a type of database, it does not have the processing power to analyze such massive large data sets. Which is the best to recommend in this situation? We'll go for data warehouse, or you'll go for big data, data mining, or business intelligence? You'll go for big data. Very good, guys. Awesome. So now we have completed two concepts. One is big data we have completed. Data warehouse also we have completed. Okay. Next is data mining. So what is data mining? So data mining, in data mining, what you do is whatever information is stored in the data warehouse, what you do is you mine it. You do mining and you try to find a few patterns and interpret and evaluate the business knowledge. Okay, I hope you wouldn't have understood. What we'll do is we'll just end the meeting here and we'll come back and I'll explain that to you. Start with data mining. So what happens in data mining is that, what happens is that, see, you would have heard of gold mines, okay, or mines like that. So what you do is you have a large mines of gold. You have large areas where golds are there. So what you do is you do mining. You excavate the place, and what you do is you find gold inside it. Correct. So what you do is there are large places where you have gold inside it. What you do is you do gold mining, that you excavate the place and you try to take gold out of it, and you take the gold out of it. The same way also data mining is also working. So in data warehouse, a lot of data will be stored there. When you do a process called as data mining, so in data mining, what is the process? That I'll tell you, but just understand for now. When you do data mining, you will be able to find out a few patterns in the data. Like how in the big billion days, you'll be able to find out a pattern that each time when I announce the big billion days, for the first 2 days, a lot of customers are purchasing. Then the next 2 days, the sales just goes down. So like that, you'll be able to find a lot of patterns from the data warehouse when you do data mining. Such patterns are then interpreted and evaluated. And from that, you try to gain business knowledge and you try to improve your business. So what happens in a data mining? From a data warehouse, you do data mining. In that, you will find a few patterns. And that patterns, when you interpret or evaluate them, you will find business knowledge, or knowledge which is required to grow your business. And using that knowledge, you can grow your business. Okay. So that is what is data mining. So here first we'll study the steps, or we'll go and study what is data mining, and we'll come back here for the steps. Yes, here we have. So data mining, what is data mining? Data mining is the process of analyzing data. So they analyze data. By doing data mining, what they do, they analyze data and they try to find a few previously unknown trends, or find a few patterns, or any associations to make decision, or any information that can help you take your decision better. They analyze the data to find all these three. What they try to find? Previously unknown trends, any patterns, or any association to make decision. Generally, data mining is accomplished through automated means. So automatically the machine itself will do it, the data mining. Okay, humans need not do it. Against extremely large set, data sets, such as data warehouse. So like in data warehouse, you'll have large amount of data, right? Because historical data is also stored in that. So this a human cannot do. So using automated means, the data mining will be done and you'll be able to find out unknown trends or patterns or some associations related to the data. So this is what is data mining. So steps related to data mining. So how do you do this data mining is what you are going to understand here. So these are the steps which is related to data mining. So first what you do is all the data which you have, you integrate into this tub, into this blue color tub which you can see here. In this tub, whatever data you have, you integrate it, you bring it all into one place. Okay. And now what you do is you select a few data from that whatever your target data is. That means data warehouse not only stores the data relating to big billion days, but a lot of other data also it may store, like the Christmas sale data, the New Year sale data, what other days you have, Diwali sale data, many sale data it might have. In that, what is your target data about? What you want to know about? You want to know about big billion day sale. So that target data alone you will select. Okay. Now what you will do is you will do processing on the data that you will process the target data. You will process the target data. Once you process the target data, that means cleaning you will do. Whatever unnecessary information is there, that and all you will take out of the data. Clean information you will take out of it, and then you will transform it. Then you will transform the data. Okay, then you will transform the data and do data mining on it. So what you will do, you will integrate all the data into one place. You will select whatever data is required by you. Then you will clean the data, whichever is selected. That means all unwanted data from that you will remove. Then you will do transformation on the data. That is, after that you will do data mining. And by doing data mining, you will find a few patterns, and that patterns you will interpret or evaluate. When you interpret or evaluate such patterns, you will get a knowledge regarding which you can take some actions, that is some business decision you can take, or you can make use of whatever knowledge you have discovered from it. So these are the steps of data mining. Are all the concepts of data clear, guys? So that's about data mining. That's it. Yes, we don't have anything else related to data mining. Yes, so that was the concept above data mining. Is data mining, is there all the concepts related to data clear? So now we have completed four components out of the five. We completed hardware, software, data, and people. Network is left. Network is only one which is left, which is very small also. We'll complete it very soon. So no problem at all. But this is also a bit technical. I want others to answer also if you have any doubts or not. Okay. So finally, we are coming towards the end of the topic, guys. The last component we are going to study. Yes. So sit on with a lot of energy. Network database model. I didn't get you. What is network? You didn't understand or what? Okay. So whatever your doubts are, you can just post it in the comment box before I leave the session and clear and move. Okay, are you asking, is this network database model? No, this is not network database model. They come on the database model. Network is something completely different. We'll understand. Okay. So in networks, you can have two parts. So what is the first? What is a network? Okay. A network is nothing but a group of devices connected to each other. If a group of devices are connected to each other, it will be known as a network. Okay. So in network, you have something known as a computer network. There may be different kinds of network. Okay. There will be a human network. There can be computer networks. There can be different kinds of networks. But here we are only studying about computer network because we are only studying about CBIS. That is computer based information system. So in this computer network, you will have a collection of computers and other hardware. Okay, other hardwares, you know what are the other hardwares, which are interconnected by communication channels that allows sharing of resources and information. Okay, I'll just show you a picture. So here, so see, you can see these are the different, what do you say, these are different computers, and this is a computer system. All those computers are interconnected to each other, and also the hardware is also connected to each other. Hardware is also connected with that. Hardware is nothing but here, your hardware is your printer. So that printer is also connected to it, okay. So see here, all the computers are connected to a common printer. So here, all those computers are connected to a common printer, which is in the middle, right? So and now they are, all the computers are also able to use it. So if one computer gives print, it will print it. If this computer gives print, it will print it. If this computer gives print, it will print it. So all the computers are connected to a common printer, and they are also able to use it. So how are they able to use it is the question here. So here there is a it's a resource. The printer is a resource which is getting shared with all the computers. Here the printer is a resource which is getting shared with all the computers. So this resource sharing is possible because all the computers are connected to a network. Only because all these computers are connected to a network, they are able to use a common resource. Okay, so this is nothing but your computer network. A computer network is nothing but, as we just read, it is a collection of computer and other hardware interconnected by communication channel that allows sharing of resources and information. All these collection of computers are able to share the resources. Resources means a printer, or any, can be any kind of resource, or also information. You can share it with one another. One computer can share with another computer. How are they able to share this? Because of network. It is possible only because of a network. Okay. So in network, there may be two types of networks. So there are two types of networks. One is connection-oriented network, and the other one is connectionless network. See, you have two types of network. One is connection-oriented network and the connection-less network. So what happens in a connection-oriented network is that, see, in a connection-oriented network, connection is first established. First, the connection is established between the sender and receiver, and then data is exchanged. So in connection-oriented network, what happens? First, connection is established between whoever the sender and the receiver is, and then the data is exchanged. Example, you can take the example of a telephone. Before you call, okay, so after you call, the network will not be established. Before you make a call itself, there will be a network which is established between you and the other user, other telephone user, and then you are able to exchange your data. You are able to pick the call and exchange your data. Okay, so what happens in networkless areas, where you don't have network at all? You know, in networkless areas, what you will be able, you'll not be able to share your information to other person at all. When you call, it will come that in this area the network is not available, so the person will not be able to pick your call. So this is a good example. So here first the network is established, and then only the sender and receiver are able to exchange the information. Okay, so this is connection-oriented network. Another example, another type of network would be connection-less network. Connection-less network means there is no prior connection made before data exchanges. Okay, before you exchange data, there is no connection made. So what happens here is that when data is being exchanged, in fact, has a complete information of the recipient. So whenever you exchange data, what happens is you will have the complete contact information of the recipient. Okay. And at each intermediate destination, it is decided how to proceed further. I'll make you understand this with the example. You would have seen this postcard systems. Okay. So what happens when you send the postcard, there is no connection made between you and the receiver. What happens on this postcard, you will have written the complete contact information of the receiver, right? You would have written the complete contact information of the receiver. So what happens is when you make a data exchange using connectionless networks, what happens is first the connection is not established. What will happen is you will have the information of the receiver. So what you do is at each intermediate destination, that means if I'm sending this postcard from Chennai to suppose Nepal, and I have an intermediate destination of Delhi. Suppose what will happen is my postcard will first go to Delhi, and from Delhi it will be sent to Nepal. So what happens in such cases, once a postcard has gone from Chennai to Delhi, then in Delhi they will decide how we have to proceed further, how we have to send this postcard to Nepal. So I hope you would have understood what is connectionless network. So data which is being exchanged, in fact, has a complete contact information of the recipient. And at each intermediate destination, it will decide how to proceed further. So this is how connectionless networks work. So we have understood both about connection-oriented network and connectionless network. I hope this is clear to you guys. So we have understood what is a computer network, then we understood what are the different network types. Okay, now we are going to understand a few issues which are related to the networks and which needs to be addressed. A few issues which are related to, in the book they would have given you like basic issues, they have put a basic issues topic and they would have given you this. So what are the issues that may come in a network is what we are going to understand now. Okay, so there are four. So as you can see here, there are four. One is routing, the other one is bandwidth, the other is resilience, and then you have contention. You have routing, bandwidth, resilience, and contention. So these are the four basic issues of a network. Okay, so first, what is routing? Okay, should I explain you this or should I not? Okay, I'll not explain, I'll directly explain the concept. I hope you understand. If you don't, then I'll get into the details. Okay. So what happens is in routing, it refers to the process of deciding how to communicate the data from source to destination network. Suppose you have a source. This is where you start the information from. And this suppose it's your destination network, destination area. Okay, so through a network only you are going to send this information or data or whatever it is. Through a network only you are going to send this. So what? So there will be a router in between. There will be a router in between. What this router will do is that it will decide. Or if you, even if you don't have a router, you can say routing is a process. It is a process. This routing process, what it will do is it will help you to decide how you are going to send the source from how you are going to send the information from source to destination. See, you can also send the information from source to destination like this. You may also send it like this. You may also send it like this. So how do you want to send your information from source to destination is what is decided by the process of routing. What routing helps you to do is, routing helps you to find the shortest distance by which you can send data. So router helps you to find the shortest distance by which you can send data from source to destination. So this is what is routing. Routing is a process of deciding on how to communicate the data from source to destination. It will help you in finding the shortest distance. So that is about routing. That is the first issue you can have when you build a network. So whenever you want to build a network, you know, if suppose I am Bhavna, okay, I want to create a network of my own, these are the four issues that will come up. So all these four issues, how am I going to address, I have to see. Next issue or next thing which I have to keep in mind when I'm developing a network is about bandwidth. It is about bandwidth. Okay, so what is the bandwidth? Is bandwidth means amount of data which can be sent across a network in a given time. So how much amount of data are you only able to send? This much amount of data, are you able to send this much amount? Are you only able to send this much amount of data, are you able to send this much amount of data? So at that particular period of time, how much data are you able to send from one place to another or through a network? How much data you are able to send from one place to another is what is bandwidth. That means you may have low bandwidth and high bandwidth. Low bandwidth means low. At a particular time, only less amount of data you will be able to send. Whereas high bandwidth means high amount of more data you will be able to send. So what happens when you have low bandwidth and high bandwidth is that, suppose I have three data. Suppose 1, 2, 3 data I have. Here also I have three data. So here, since the bandwidth is low, one by one only my data will be able to go. Whereas here, since the bandwidth is high, all the three datas at one time I'll be able to send. A good example, not example, a thing which you can, which you will be able to understand is, let's see, what happens is, if you have, if you use WhatsApp, you know, if you use WhatsApp, what will happen is that in WhatsApp, you know, suppose I send a few images to my friends, suppose I send 5 images to my friends, what will happen is, when I'm using a 2G network, slowly 1, 2, 3, 4, like this only the data will be sent, my images will be sent. Whereas if I send my data or my images through 5G, how will be the data sent? Tap, 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 that sound will come in, will go and come. Okay, so this is how your speed will also increase if the bandwidth is more. So 2G has a very small bandwidth, only a small area through which it can send its data, whereas 5G has a lot of bandwidth to itself. So bandwidth is nothing but the amount of data which can be sent across a network in a given time. So it also, higher the bandwidth, higher will be your speed. Okay, so this is one thing that I have to remember while I build a network. Next is resilience. So resilience means the ability of a network to recover from any kind of error like connection failure or loss of data. So here you can see, so if suppose what happens is suddenly there is a connection failure, that means what happens due to something, due to rain or due to any other thing, sometimes what happens is that when you switch on a TV, you know, if you are using the TV via cable or via internet or whatever, sometimes suddenly your internet will not working when the rain pours down, or what will happen is suddenly your cable will go off from the TV when your rain is heavily pouring down. So what happens is, in that time, what is the ability of your network? So what might happen is, some networks which are there, you know, like Tata Sky or big networks, they will establish their connection very soon, whereas this local cable channels and all, it will take a lot of time to establish a connection and it will take a lot of time for your TV to start again. So the ability of a network to recover, from any kind of error is known as resilience. So how fast are you able to see? This man is trying to make all the blocks stand, all the falling blocks, he is trying to make it stand. That means he is trying to be resilient. So what is the ability of a network to recover from any kind of loss? There may be loss of data or connection failure or anything. That is known as resilience. I hope resilience is clear to you all. And the final issue that I have to keep in my mind when I build a network is that about contention. So here, as you can see, two people are fighting. These two people may fight over a lock or they may fight over a network also. So these two people are fighting. So what happens here is that it refers to the situation that arises when there is a conflict for some common resource in a network. So if two people are trying to reach on a common resource in a network, then in such case, what will happen? That situation is known as contention. When two people have a conflict over a common resource in a network, that is known as contention. For example, network contention could arise when two or more computer systems try to communicate at the same time. If two or more computer systems are trying to communicate to a printer at once, then you may have a connection problem. Or else sometimes what happens is, if there is a person and two people are trying to call the same person at the same time, in such case that conflict will come. The common resource, they are trying to the network is trying to reach to a common resource, but when two people call at the same time, the contention might happen. So it refers to a situation that arises when there is a conflict between the common resource in a network. So these are the four issues that have been addressed, that have to be addressed when you build a network. Okay. So now we have completed, what have we completed? We completed types of network, basic issues, and final topic, guys, last topic of the day, telecommunication impacts. Okay. Before we go to that, try to answer this. So ability of a network to recover from any kind of error like connection failure, loss of data, etc. is referred as bandwidth or routing or contention or resilience. Try to answer. Resilience, contention, resilience, D. Resilience. Someone told me contention. So whenever you study, remember about contention, you have these images in front of your minds, you're able to recall it. Contention means two people fight over something, whereas resilience means someone is trying to make things better. He's trying to keep the walls standing. Okay, it's trying to recover something. So the answer is resilience. Okay, I hope if you didn't understand what I just said and if you were wrong on your part, you can go and watch it on rewatch it on YouTube whenever I upload. Okay, so how it achieves. So here the topic is telecommunication impacts. Okay, guys. So this topic, if you read, I think you'll be able to understand it. So it enables to transmit the raw data information quickly and accurately. Okay. Telecommunication enables an organization with geographically remote areas to also function. It makes it possible to create systems which restructure the interactions. So all these small topics relating benefits, disadvantages, how it achieves and all, you can go once you're reading the book, once you read it, you'll be able to understand. So yes, guys, so this was all about your part one of chapter number 3, your information system components. Yes, thank you so much for joining in.